They were the first hedge fund in Sweden, and now they're one of the leading fund managers in Europe. Brummer and Partners pride themselves on clear principles, honoring the high standards of the Nordic investor community, and being devoted to big data analysis and mathematics, along with, they say, a healthy dose of humility and a determination to survive. I'm Andrew Wilson, and I'm in Davos to find out how they do it. Mikael, good to talk to you. First of all, tell me a bit about what sets you apart from the herd. Tell me a bit about Brummer and Partners.
Okay, well, first, thank you for having me here and inviting us. Well, I guess to answer your question, the main answer is that there is no secret sauce or magic formula. Instead, it's a set of powerful structures, principles, and processes that has been developed and tested throughout time. And as a firm, what we are, of course, is an absolute return business, where our main product or focus surrounds the multi-strategy concepts. We have a set of different hedge fund strategies that complement each other that we also then use to try to optimize a good risk-adjusted return in a multi-strategy concept. And that's what I work with on a day-to-day basis.
Something that's constantly on the move, I guess. What trends do you see coming up on the horizon?
Well, we just enter into a new decade. And for me, it's natural to perhaps look back a bit on the decade that we just left behind us. And it's easy to conclude and to see that the last decade was truly extraordinary for financial markets and risky assets in particular. And what I mean by extraordinary is, of course, there are returns that we saw last decade. And of course, there's been many powerful structures in place and forces to generate these type of returns. And most importantly, of course, is the monetary policies that, not to say the least, has been extraordinary and experimental even. And of course, that has underpinned this extraordinary growth in asset prices, or even perhaps created asset inflation, I would say.
And that can make you complacent. I mean, you have to keep your eye on the risk-reward balance all the time, I guess.
Yeah, and of course, here and now, the effects of the monetary policies, I'm pretty sure to say that it's diminishing. And of course, then we have the obvious question marks such as, okay, is there room for fiscal policy to take over? What about all the geopolitical risks and challenges that we unfortunately see in the day to day in the world, of everything from trade war to now an escalated situation in Iran, to of course also here in Europe, what will the European Union look like after Brexit? And how powerful will the European Union be? Will it be further weakened? The main takeaway for me is, of course, that in this new decade that lies ahead of us, the risk-reward ratio that you mentioned will look completely different. And to the worse, unfortunately, for all investors. And I think then, as any investor, we or anyone who's buy and hold or retail investor, you have to be much more careful assessing the risk-reward ratio of the investments that you're looking at. And also in this context, portfolio construction and sources of diversification will be much more to pay attention to.
The other issue that's becoming more of a factor these days is sustainability. It's a buzzword for many companies, but also in general around the planet, people are conscious now that sustainability is an issue as well.
Yeah, I would say for us, I'm a Swede and from Scandinavia, sustainability has always been important for us, and especially the investor side has always put demands and requirements on us. So I would argue that our business model is founded on sustainable principles. And also as a hedge fund firm, Brummer Partners, one of the founders for the Standard Board of Alternative Investments, which is an organization that sets principles for sustainability example. But my main takeaway or advice even, if I may, when it comes to sustainability is that each firm really has to define what it means to them. We've been working on this now intensively more for the last few years, really defining what it means for us, both in terms of the investment activities, but also when it comes to us as a business.
Now, bearing in mind all those geopolitics you mentioned a moment ago and the changing shape of the way the world is relating to each other and so on, you mention a lot in your company literature about that the survival of the fittest is an important concept in terms of the work that you do. How are you going to bring that to bear if the next decade gets difficult?
I work in a survival of the fittest type of business. It's pure Darwinism. And you need to adapt, meaning you need to deliver the risk-adjusted returns driven by alpha. Unless you do, investors do something else with their money. So in this type of environment that I'm active in, you need to adapt to markets. And we talked about the regime shift, if I may call it, from a macroeconomic perspective. What we've also seen picking up the last few years, which is quite important for someone like us, is the change in market dynamics, where, for example, the growth of passive investments such as ETFs and risk parity products and also money being managed beyond the traditional CTAs has profoundly changed flow dynamics in certain parts of the market. And in particular, I'm referring to the equity markets. And it leads to, for example, more leverage in the system and more crowded position, which also leads to changes in risk dynamics when investors change their sentiment towards risk. So we have seen now increased periods of high volatility and deeper drawdowns. And that's something we need to adapt to. And that's something we paid a lot of attention to the last 2 years. And that's an example of trying to survive and adapt to the regime that you lays in front of you. It's always important to try to be adaptive to the changing market dynamics. But in the context of a regime shift, where we are right now, I think it's more important than ever.
And in terms of Brummer and Partners then, you have what people are popularly referred to now as the Nordic DNA. Mm-hmm. How does that play into how you work, and does that give you an advantage? Is that some special ethos you bring to your work?
Well, so we've been in business for almost 25 years now, and obviously our firm and our business model is founded on a set of principles, which I like to label them Nordic in many regards. So the foundation is the business model, which in our case is a true partnership model, which allows a long-term perspective. And in our business, a long-term perspective has been, actually it's been part of our secret sauce, not to be constrained to short-term greed, to have a sound business model which allows alignment of interest, both when it comes to managing money, of course, but also to how you run the business, to ensure that everybody has the aligned interest and can focus on the long-term. I mean, it's hard as it is anyway. And in addition to that, of course, investors that we mentioned, putting high regards on sustainability and so forth. I mean, I think the investor base in the Nordics is quite sophisticated, and of course that influences us as well. So there are many pieces to that Nordic DNA, if you will.
Is there an element of humanity in that? I mean, you've mentioned humility.
Yes, we can call it greedy, but not too greedy, is one way of saying it. But another way of saying it is that you need to be humble in this business. I think that's what we mean when we decided our business model. You need a humble approach, and that to some extent is part of Nordic DNA as well. That's how you survive long-term in this business.
So you've survived for 25 years. There's another 25 years coming up. Are you ready to deal with that as well? Are you optimistic about the future?
I'm optimistic about the future, but as we talked about, the coming decade now might have some challenges, absolutely. Much more than the decade we just left behind, is that I'm pretty sure about. But on the other hand, that's our job, to identify the opportunities that the market gives us and to capitalize on that. But I am optimistic about our ability to deliver.
Mikael, thanks very much. Good talking to you.
Thank you.